Hi there. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Global XR Talks in March 17. Today we have one session. We actually had two sessions, but the first session has been postponed due to technical reasons, and that will be held again in May 26th. So the session is not gone, but is moved to another day. So today we have one session, and that is XR at the Dutch police. So let's get the people in the call.
Hi, welcome.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for
here. Yes.
So you're going to do an awesome session about all your experiences with XR at the Dutch police, right?
Yeah, we will give you an overview of what we do. And hopefully there comes some new ideas about it. So,
yeah. Okay. Cool. Yeah. Can you introduce yourself, Gerard? Let's start with you.
Yeah, my name is Gerard ten Buren. I'm working at the Dutch police. I'm a technical advisor. And the last 3-4 years, I'm involved with VR, let's say XR.
Cool. And Alex, can you introduce yourself?
Yes, my name is Alexander de Bruin. I work at the Netherlands police for 21 years. My specialties are originally digital twinning of crime scenes and developing VR applications.
Oh, that sounds really cool. Yeah. And Nanko, not last but not least, definitely.
Yeah. Thank you, Alexander. Now, I'm Nanko Audians. I'm a Dutch police officer and working in the east of Holland, the Netherlands, of Nijmegen. And I'm studying at this moment at the Police Academy for Bachelor of Policing, and I'm busy also during my study with innovations of the XR with Gerard and Alex.
Nice. Okay. So I think not everyone is going to expect something indeed in first, because when you talk about XR, you're not thinking the first thing at the Dutch police. But I know it's different, so I want to give you the controls, or let's say the presentation, and let you start and allow you to show the people what you actually do nowadays, which is major cool. So
yeah. Good luck.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Alexander and Schauke, for this opportunity. We will give you in the presentation an overview of the Dutch police and what we are doing. Then we have we will do a little bit of about XR and the operational content. We show you several XR projects, and then at the end, but not the least, Alex will give some presentation about forensics within the police. So who we are now, this is already told, so we can start with the projects. The Dutch police we have in Holland 65,000 employees. Most of them are police officers, and the main tasks are investigation, enforcement of course of the law, and helping in emergency situations. And of course, there are also many people involved with technology to get the police ready for the future. So the possibilities for the police with XR is very big. You can use it for forensics. Example, freezing a crime scene. Also, criminal is the investigation for training for police officers, for special police teams. And you see some examples here with, with some pictures from large areas, for special areas, and also one of the biggest things is the coordinating for the police, and 3D gives a special view of this. The last, 4 years, we started in 2016, we got an HoloLens, but very soon we saw not the real, for the future, yes, but not at that moment, possibilities for the police, and we started in the beginning with VR glasses from HTC. And we did several projects within the police. We started with the visualization of crime scenes for forensics. Alex was closely involved with that. And later on, we did some projects for see how VR will perform for the police and all kind of other things. In the police, there are many people involved with ideas around virtual reality. Now I will introduce you to Nanko, and he will tell you a little bit about the operational context.
Yes, thank you, Gerard. What I thought, I'm sitting at this moment at the police academy. And I want to give you an idea of what we're doing why are we using XR in the preparation of the police officers for doing their jobs. For my study, I was I had to do a research as well for everyone who is doing a study. I started with a small idea, and that ends with a big research of what can do a VR for event preparations. What we see in the Netherlands is a lot of events, and the amount of the number of events is growing every year. But also the corona is not helping at this moment, but we think actually that it will rise again to the maximum, and we have the event areas will be more and more complex. So what was my idea is to have do a research, because we cannot go on the event area at this moment. So What I thought, can VR help us with that, to have a preparation, not come into the event area, and what can it help us? If the police officer can scan or look around in the event area. So I took two groups, a normal preparation by briefing and a map study, and the VR preparation. And after the preparation, they have to go by foot on a real life event, on the Trafford Park event. It was a big event of 65,000 visitors, and what we saw is what we have to the question is, do police officers perform better at navigation from A to B at an event area, or do they experience less stress both during and after performing their task? And what we saw is that the results on both questions showed significant outputs on both questions. So it was very interesting, because they did the research part was very interesting, but also the technical part. It was 2019. We talk about the HTC 5 Pro, and we want to have a simulation of the 65,000 dancing, yelling crowds, and. And the 500 by 500 meters, which you can see on the photo of the event area. Alex and his crew made a lighter point cloud of the event area, but then it was empty, of course. And we get from the event group the CAD models and the technical boys and 10 students of the university combine them together in a map with the crowd simulation. And you can the VR preparation group get a tour. It was by I designed it with from the literature how to navigate in a short time and that you can know the environment. So that was the research. It was very nice, and it was a big research with a lot of researchers in it. But I want to dive into the theory behind it. Why we use VR and for this case, and why it helps. Gerard, can you show the next page? Yeah, we have about situational awareness. And if you look to situational awareness, the case is if you know the unknown environment, because you already saw it in VR and by virtual in environment, it helps you to make a better decision and on the performance of actions. So, but that's not what I investigate or research, but that showed the literature. If you take a deeper dive into the theory, then you see in the center of the model from Ansley, the situational awareness. If you look there to the first level, if you look there, maybe it's a little bit small detailed, but what it shows, if you know the environment because you already saw it in VR, and you know the dangerous situations, or you can identify them easily. So it costs you less brain capacity. So we use it for that's the theory behind the VR preparation. But if you look at to another domain of our work in the operations, that's the next next slide. We use at this moment you see a table where we show the 2D environment. That's the way we now look to common operational picture, or how we look to the environment. What we see if to the literature and 3D, what 3D mapping, it gives you a lot of more possibilities to have a good common operational picture. That's what also Alex told about the digital twin of the environment. If you can look to the digital twin, you have a better common operational picture. And what we do in the Netherlands, but also in other countries, we use the BOP model. In Dutch, is that build forming, the review, the oordeels forming, assessment, and besluit forming, the decision making. So. If you can look to one model of the environment in 3D by a mix of virtualizations like VR, mixed reality, and later on we show you some nice proof of concepts at this moment, you can look to the environment. But what is a very interesting part, if you can put a sensing, can you sensor data and intelligence and geodata on top of it, the digital twin, you can have a better spatial planning in 3D. And also you see more depth and coherence. And so that's the theory and that showed the literature at this point, if you use XR techniques, to have a better 3D common operational picture. The next slide, but Gerard will talk about the technical decision, show what we are proving at this moment of this part. So thank you.
Thank you, Nanko. Yes, from that point of view, we started with a new point of view, that is with mixed reality. This is our first step into it. Alexander Meijer helped us with building this model. He did a lot of work for us. And what you here see is it's a 3D model of the Waalkade in Nijmegen. And what you can see is that you can walk around it, and you see also all the buildings in 3D relation with each other. What we also want to do is put in all kind of sensor data, and the first step for this is to have some anchors put into the model. And in a later stadium, what you can do is, let's say, have some geo information automatically put into the model. And now you can give all the people who looks to the same model, give a good understanding how it looks at that moment. And maybe in the future, you can also combine this with crowd information and to give, let's say, decision makers a good overview of the situation. So I think this will be the next step to, let's say, VR, to do use a mixed reality and maybe combine it. Maybe you can have, let's say, a view like this with mixed reality. This is with the HoloLens 2. Combine with people who are remote, let's say, with an Oculus Quest joining you on the to this location and in the discussion. And I think also within the police, we must investigate how this works for the police. And that's very interesting for us to do. And I think it gives us, the police, big opportunities. So what will we need to do to make this kind of models and make it work? It's of course the 3D understanding of the world. Maybe we can buy 3D information, let's say big cities, combine that with building information from CAD BIM models, and also combine it with scan data from for forensics example, or special locations what is have special interest for the police, and at the end combine that with all kinds of other sensor information in the form of anchors, and then you must put that all together, and maybe you can use Unity, maybe you can use other kinds of platforms to get maybe simulations into the model, but and also the that you can make the model interactive. At the end, we will want to distribute this kind of information, so that you can work together, and also that all the policemen can use this information. And we looking at this moment into this problem, because of course 3D models at this moment it's large models and a lot of information, and you must distribute it to the users and maybe all kinds of platforms. So when you look to 3D scanning, also Alex has a lot of experience with this. We're looking for new kinds of things, but the forensic part, they use a lot of, let's say, FARO scanners, but also at the right, also a backpack scanners to scan large areas with a high resolution. Also, we use drones for this to with photogrammetry, make 3D models of it. And what you also see nowadays that you can use for, of course, a lower resolution. Let's say the newest iPhone 12 to scan certain objects. It's a lower resolution because with the Faro, I think you are on millimeters resolution, and that is not reachable for the iPhone scanners. But also robotics come into this solution. We have a spot from Boston Dynamics, and we combine this with a Faro scanner, and for at the end to go to difficult locations to get also a 3D scans of it. Maybe Alex, do you have some remarks on this?
Well, the drone looks kind of ancient. I think we use DJI inspired drones nowadays and Mavic 2s, but this is a very old one.
Yeah, this is the first one. We started with your team, I think, in 2010, 2012, with this drone to map the first building or a historic building from Austerlitz to see how it performed. And we were at that time amazed how good it was. So, and that was this drone. So this drone, I think it is about 10 years old.
Yes, if I remember correctly, we reconstructed the pyramid of Austerlitz within 10 centimeters of accuracy.
Yeah. So last year we test for the police AR glasses. What we did, the students of the Hans Hogeschool in Groningen built an application for a navigation in combining with the Vuzix Blade glass. And there was a navigational tool built for that with points of interest. And what we did is took a big group of, I think, 60 people to look how it will perform. And that was amazing what we saw. First of all, when I put on the glass and saw all the kind of information, I was astonished. And one of the problems what we saw is that when you are looking to your environment, but you have extra information, a lot of extra information for navigation, it was sometimes dangerous, and you must be careful to not walk in front of a car. At the other hand, it was also interesting to see, let's say, with points of interest, when there is, let's say, somewhere where there is information that a lot of bicycles were stolen, that you can get when you are in the neighborhood of that region, that you get a pop-up for that kind of information. And I think the opportunities for this is very interesting. What the disadvantage is, you must be very careful to put not too much information into the glass. And another thing, what I also saw is that the battery lifetime is not enough for the police. It was about 2 hours. And normally the police are in, let's say, several hours and into action. But there are a lot of opportunities for this kind of technology. And maybe in combination with remotely, in combination with the mixed reality environment, on that you can pinpoint, let's say, in the police station, where to look or where new information is, and then upload it to this kind of glasses as a point of interest. an other test what we did with another school. It was with the Hogeschool Windesheim. 5 or 6 students worked 10 weeks on this application. We want to make an application, a proof of concept for searching a house or a building, and to get information into an app to give background information on a later date. So what we did is points text into a room where we found information. So what you saw is a mobile device, and here you see documentation or a USB driver, and then have some put some extra information, text information or pictures with it to give give this an extra content on context. So also this, you can also combine it with a big database and to show and combine this with, let's say, external models where we find some information and where and what kind of information it was. This was also done with the iPhone 12. And this, it was a very, very good job from the students who were not really into the iPhone, but they did. They made now an application what we can now test in practice, and the first results are very promising. So, Alex, the floor is yours.
Well, thank you, Gerard. Let's break the first rule of presentations. Never let the technical person talk too much. But here we go. Like I said, my name is Alexander de Bruin. I've been working at the forensic department of the police for about 21 years, of which the last 6 years at a national agency. And I'm going to tell you something about a small practice case that we actually did. Normally, what I do is I make digital twins of crime scenes with photogrammetry, drone photogrammetry, laser scanners, and such, and we can use the data we gather for court cases. In the last few years, we started to do more with virtual reality, and we even had court cases done in virtual reality. But this one is slightly different. A few years ago, in 2018, we were approached by the Netherlands Forensic Institute regarding a proficiency test for the ENSFI, that's the European Network of Forensic Science Institutes. They gave a congress in Lyon for all of Europe. And at that congress, they wanted to present a proficiency test. It's a large test. 72 investigators had to investigate one crime scene, and they were evaluated on their performance. So how did they follow guidelines? How were laboratory investigations conducted? Did they find all the trace evidence that was present at the crime scene? There were people involved from 17 countries, and you can imagine that that's tricky to set up. Because all persons had to have a fair chance in this proficiency test. They all had to investigate the same crime scene. And that is difficult because you can imagine that, well, if you have a mock crime scene, you have to set up the crime scene exactly the same every time that you use it. And you have to transport all the people to that crime scene. And we have only a few practice houses at the Netherlands Police Academy in Apeldoorn. But those houses are nearly booked all year round. And if you have to host 47, if I remember correctly, people, then that's very hard. Gerard, I forgot to tell you to skip the slide. Can you please skip 2 slides?
The next one.
Okay. Sorry. I was clicking away in my own PowerPoint presentation. small noob mistake, but it happens. So it's very hard to actually accommodate for 47 different people in the same crime scene. And it's, what I said, almost impossible to set up exactly the same crime scene 47 times. So we start to look at other ways how we could distribute a crime scene to people. Can you skip a slide, please, Gerard? In the past, we have done this before for several psychological evaluations of how people react to crime scenes. And in those times, we used panoramic photography. So we went to a specific crime scene that was set up for us. We made a lot of 360 imagery, and that was presented as a linked presentation in a web browser. And people were able to investigate the crime scene in this way. So we have experience with that, and we have done it before. Only there are a few problems with it. In the first place, if I take just pictures and I present those pictures to people, you actually guide people to specific pieces of trace evidence. And the second thing is that you don't have the same feeling of immersion because it is a picture. It's a two-dimensional picture, and you don't get a feeling of depth. You don't get a feeling of relation, how rooms and evidence relates to each other in space. So that was the evaluation we got from that was that it was not found us to be very realistic. So we had to try something new. And well, of course, next slide, please. We try to refer to a true and tried Danish innovative reconstruction technique, Legos, but that was quickly shut down. Next slide, please. So we had to do something with VR. In those times, we were involved with a project with Gerard. We tried from what can we do with our laser scan data and how can we present that in a way that's understandable for people. Because laser scans are very high resolution, three-dimensional data, but it's very hard for people to actually use the data because point clouds are very large, they're heavy for your computer. And besides point clouds, points don't have a volume, so you can look between the points, but you can make meshes from them. And we decided to use that. And we built an application around that. And what we actually did was we built a presentation first with the point cloud itself, because we are used to think in a forensic context, and we have to present our base data. So we took Unity, we found a point cloud engine, and we put a point cloud in Unity. But people don't experience point clouds in a very comfortable way. So we also needed a 3D model. So we converted the point cloud with point views, and we put the panoramic images in, and we had a complete presentation. So the user was able to walk in the crime scene itself and inspect specific data points that we brought in. So a lot of 360 imagery and a lot of photographs that were coupled to a position. But because we did not want to guide people, they actually had to search for photographic clues. So there are maybe 200 more clues than the actual pieces that they had to find hidden everywhere in the crime scene. And they had to really inspect the entire 3D model very minutely. They had to be within 30 centimeters of a piece of evidence before it would pop up. And that way they could inspect the entire crime scene. And depending on what they found, they were able to ask questions to a, let's call it a game master, and were able to open laboratory investigations to specific pieces of evidence to couple things to the crime scene. And depending on how they did that, their performance was evaluated. Only we are talking about 2018, and regarding virtual reality techniques, that's ancient times. Not everybody was able to use a virtual reality helmet. So we built the application in such a way that you can also use it as a single person game-like application. So you can navigate with your mouse and keyboard and walk around in it. Can you skip two slides, Gerard? And this is what it looked like. What you're seeing here is a converted laser scan made into a 3D model. It's done by an automatic process with point views from Arithmica, I think. You also can see the panoramic images, so you have a very realistic view. You can zoom in. You can switch to the point cloud view to verify the 3D model to the point cloud. That will happen in a few seconds, I think. This is the free meeting rule again. And there's the point cloud. It takes a while to build up. We include a point cloud in these kinds of models because if we have to go to court, we have to show the court that the 3D model that we're showing actually corresponds to our calibrated 3D data. That's why we always include the point cloud. Later in our evaluation, we found that for this specific application, it was not needed, and we could have skipped it, and it would have saved us about 200 megabytes on the resulting executable. So it would have been easier to distribute if we took it out. So that's a lesson for the next time. Can you skip one slide, Gerard? So eventually we got some feedback. Slow computer. So eventually we got some feedback. We really asked for critical feedback because it was a learning curve for us too. We learned a lot from this project. Most people who just saw the application and used it were overwhelmingly positive. From 47 people, only 14 people responded with feedback, and most people were very positive. It turned out that only 2 people actually used the VR application, and the rest all used the first person mode. Most took 2 days in the in-game to actually evaluate it, and it worked very well. And we were invited to do it again next year. So that was a success. The biggest things that we actually learned were 2 things. That we were very amateuristic in developing for Unity, and building good architecture in Unity is very hard. But it turns out that the user doesn't care how it works, and it can be spaghetti code on the back end. It doesn't matter. All that matters is user experience. If the user doesn't understand what he's doing or how he should use it, you have done everything for nothing. So that was a big learning experience for us. One slide, Gerard. I would like to thank people who actually designed the game we were doing. We just did a technical part. We incorporated all the 3D models and the point clouds. The case itself was designed by the N3 Working Group Cream of Science. You see all the names here. And thank you for your time. And I, if there are any questions, I will answer them at the end of this the rest of the presentation. And back to you, Gerard.
Yeah, I think we are at the end of this presentation. And last remark from our side, it is very important to share experience and work together to get XR to a higher level. We think the Dutch police, but also in general, police in general, XR gives opportunities for us what was never before possible. It's for training, it's for preparation, and also for coordination. And we would like to work together within the police, of course, with our colleagues, but also with knowledge centers, companies, and also nerds like who work with this kind of technology. So when you have ideas, technical or operational, give us a call, and that would be very nice, and we will like that. Okay, thank you. And yeah, it's open for questions.
So we were still on mute. Yes, there we are. Really a great session. Thank you very much. A lot of interesting stuff that you are working on at the police. Really, really nice. We have a couple of questions. Let me check in the chat. Let me see. We have one question from Marjolein, and she asks, how much time did it take to create this 3D Waalkade area?
Alexander, will you give an answer on this question?
I can actually answer that question. So I've been helping out the guys with this. It's not a simple answer to be honest, because creating a model like that depends on two things. One is you need actually the 3D model. And one of the biggest challenges with a 3D model, which has lots of detail, it means it is very large to be used in like a tool like Unity. So it requires a lot of compute power to actually get it up and running. So what we actually did was we used Azure Remote Rendering, which is a remote rendering service. And that remote rendering service, that's actually spinning up servers in the cloud and does the rendering for you and brings it into the HoloLens device. And then we use what we call a hybrid scenario, which means that we're able to add our own interactions on it, like the icons we had. And the next step we are actually working on is creating the ability to have to draw lines or to indicate certain points, and then actually connect it to outside backend systems with other information. But it's setting this up requires a lot of work on the model, while the application itself will take a few days to actually set up. But that's the start. Then you have to start all the other things, and that takes much longer.
That's the next phase, Alexander.
That's the next phase, indeed.
Yeah. Okay. We have one more question. The glasses that you've shown in your presentation, is that like Google Glasses?
Yes, I think this is the next step. We used the Fusix blade. And what I told you is one of the problems was the battery lifetime and also the brightness of the glasses. And what you see now is that Fusix will, in the middle of this year, comes with a new glasses with more performance and better battery lifetime. And also what you see is that Facebook and Apple work also at AR glasses. So it will be getting the next 2 years a very big boost.
Is there a reason why you guys chosen to use Fusix instead of, for example, RealWear or another type of device like Nreal?
The interesting thing here is that this is the glasses look like big, bulky sunglasses, and what you see is that citizens don't like. Let's say they want to make contact with police, and everything what is between it. In connecting with police officers on the street is not good. So it's for the glass, but also let's say when you have a mobile phone and the police officer is involved with his mobile phone, it's also not quite connecting. So at that part, we also did some investigation, and the results will be available, I think, this month or something like that. Yeah. So we looked into that kind of problem, interacting with the citizens when you use technical equipment.
Yeah, that sounds logical. One more question from Joost. Is this all HoloLens 1 or HoloLens 2 based?
The mixed reality is HoloLens 2 based.
Okay, great.
And so all the other tools like the physics glasses, VR headsets, etc.
Yeah. When you look to for the VR, we use most of the time HTC Vive. And nowadays also more and more, let's say, the standalone glasses like the Quest, and we're looking into new glasses, but that's also the problem. There are so many possibilities nowadays, and it will be more and more and every glass has its own needs and but also the possibilities.
Yeah,
I think we're through all the questions. Yeah. I actually had one other question to Alex. What's about the you talked about the PowerPoint cloud engine you were using in Unity. I'm not sure if the I'm just curious what engine did you use for that, and I'm also curious because you're building up a complete virtual crime scene, how long it takes to actually set something like that up. Because I can imagine that if you want to do that for every crime scene and it takes days or weeks to do this, is that it, does that make sense? So I'm just curious about that.
Well, the first question about the point cloud, the engine that we use is actually a modified version of the Potree engine. That's an engine that's very widely used in the GL world on the internet. That's a WebGL-based solution, so it's open source. It's actually adapted for use in Unity by Sebastian Maximilian Freis. He has a repository on GitHub, and I think he works at the University in Zurich.
Ah.
So we use his work. From all the point cloud engines that we actually tried and experimented with and actually had one prototype developed, this open source engine performed the best. So we actually used that, and it works really well. At very high loads, it produces a very high frame rate because those are large data sets. Producing a crime scene in VR, we did most of the work in our development phase. So we actually built a template in Unity. We just changed the assets. We just changed the 3D model, aligned it with the point cloud, placed some pictures, and within 4 hours you actually have the Unity project itself. The data processing step before that, of course, takes longer because you have to scan the entire crime scene, and that can take, depending on the size of the crime scene, anything between two hours to a full day. But generally speaking, for a four-bedroom family home, it takes 2 hours.
So within 1 day, 1.5 day, you're actually ready to use it. That's actually, that's quick. That's impressive.
Yeah, lots of practice.
yeah, right.
But it used to take longer, but computers get faster. And
yeah, that's a very good point. we had one other question I see from Marjolein. Let me put it in there. Could you give an example of a specific task of the proficiency test when was someone considered successful in completing or solving, what the criteria was then in that case?
Well, the criteria were very specific, and the proficiency test is done now, so I can actually talk about it. One of the things that was very visible, one of the problems with the crime scene was you had to match a piece of evidence, in this case a balaclava, that's a kind of mask you can wear, ski muts, was it ook wel in Nederlands? And it was used by a pair of burglars that went into this home. When they broke into that home, they actually had to smash in a window and they had to smash in a display case that was visible in the window. Those leave very small fragments of glass on the balaclava. So they actually got the balaclava with the mission, how can I match this balaclava to this crime scene? It had to investigate the crime scene to find pieces of imagery that could give an indication if I do this sampling procedure on this balaclava, I can actually tie it in a very unique way to this combination of glass to this crime scene. So they had to treat the balaclava in such a way that the particles of glass were not lost, and they had to find old pieces of glass that were uniquely visible in the crime scene. And this is a very big challenge. This is one of the breaking points of where this simulation actually falls apart. Because if you enter this crime scene in real life, the first thing that you notice is that there's glass on the ground because you can feel it under your shoes. You see it sparkle on the floor. And those are experiences that you actually lose in virtual reality. So we had to include very explicit pieces of photograph that were very explicit from there's a particle of glass right here. But you first had to find that specific picture.
Wow.
And if the investigator actually found it, that piece of evidence and was smart enough to see the cop, was knowledgeable enough that he could make the combination that a combination of three different broken panes of glass, that it gives a very unique signature that you can tie to this balaclava, then he had successfully completed the test. If they also sampled the balaclava correctly and actually found the piece of glass that were available on the physical piece of evidence.
Nice. I have another question. It's coming in.
Yes.
Are you currently working with students? Is that something you would consider again in the future?
Yes, I can answer that. Yes, we do. We are now involving with the Hanse Hogeschool with students to make an interacting flyer with augmented reality with our standard mobile phones. And what is great to work with students is that they are new in the field, so they don't have any idea from how an experience. So they are open for new things, and it is very interesting to do a proof of concept with them. I don't think you must use students for making products, what you can use for a long time. But for this kind of proof of concept and to show policemen what you can do with this new technology, it's great.
Thanks. I had one last question myself, and it was actually there are more questions.
Yeah, there's one more.
Yeah, well, before I am going to ask that question, I want to ask, because I want to go back to Alex with the crime scene. I just was wondering, yeah, because that's a really interesting one. I'm just wondering, did you ever find a clue or solve something additionally, which you initially didn't? So by using the virtual crime scene, I know you can't answer what you found, but...
Well, I actually once left the crime scene, and when I was walking outside, I thought, what am I hearing? There's something under my shoe, and I actually had a bullet casing stuck in my soles. So no, we actually did because when we scan a crime scene, we use high definition laser scanners. So we actually sample a crime scene. Depending on which scanner we use, within 5 millimeters of accuracy, with millions, literally millions of points. So it does happen that at some point later in the investigation, somebody finds a bullet casing or a witness stands up and says, well, I saw the shooter standing there and he was shooting that way. And we actually find a bullet impact hole at a place that wasn't found before. And it was still visible in the laser scans.
Wow.
And you have to think about this, that we are actually scanning since 2006. So we actually have a recorded archive of big crime scenes that goes back all that way.
So that you can actually use that to train people within the police to understand how crime scenes are.
Yes. In Amsterdam, a very interesting project is running under Roxy van der Langkruis. And she's actually trying to incorporate laser scans and virtual reality for training and knowledge transfer of crime scene investigators.
Wow.
Yeah, and the same at the police academy. They not for maybe special for crime scenes, but also to train policemen in virtual reality.
Yeah.
I think we have. Let's have the last question, and I think it's a question for each of you. So I would say that each of one answer that question. So, what is your biggest and your most proud of project you worked on?
Yeah, related.
Nanko, you first.
Related to the Dutch
police. Yeah. my own research, of course, but the Nijmegen Wildcard is also a really nice one. But yeah, the research is the most interesting one because it was a lot of work and it was technical and also a very interesting project. Yeah.
Cool. And Alex.
Well, that's actually a very easy one. The one I'm most proud of is the total reconstruction of the MH17 plane, which we all the pieces of wreckage were scanned with hand scanners within sub-millimeter accuracy, and the entire plane was reconstructed based on the wreckage in 3D. And we were actually able to make calculations based on that. So that's a very big project. It took literally months and months of work, but was very satisfying to work on.
And last but not least, Gerard.
yes, try maybe, to top that.
No, that is not possible. But I was very impressed of the student project, the VOTD app that I managed in 10 weeks, such an usable product. So we can now go into for searching a house and show the policeman how it works and what you can do with it. And there are now, at this moment, we have new ideas to make it multi-user and also use it also outside for some things. And also outside of the police, I see many possibilities to use this kind of apps.
Yeah. Thank you.
In 10 weeks' time. So that was impressive.
Very usable, very good product.
Hey guys, thank you all. It's actually time. I want to thank you all for showing us what the police, in this case the Dutch police, does with XR. I think a lot of people didn't expect this. No. And I think that's good.
And I really hope that you will come back in about a year or something like that and show us what you've done in that year.
Definitely.
Yeah, that would be really great.
We will do that. Yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you for this opportunity. And till next time.
Thank you
all. Very much.
So let's close for today. We still have the, if you want, we still have the AltSpace VR environment open. So I will join there in a few minutes. If you want to chat something extra, sometime additionally. And otherwise, we see you next time. And we have I can reveal a little bit about that. We have a very special edition of Global XR Talks, which will happen on April 1st. It's not a joke. It's actual on April 1st. It's going to be about, shall we say, the subject?
Yeah, let's do that.
Yeah, let's say the subject. Yeah. So it's going to be about Microsoft Mesh, and we're going to have a very, very interesting speakers from Microsoft and outside of Microsoft.
Yeah.
So keep an eye on our channels, and we will keep you posted on that one.
And hope to see you in AltSpace VR in a bit.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.